The Lord be with you. And good morning and welcome to God's house. It's good to see you. And as you know, we're kind of going every other pew and being careful not to sit immediately behind anyone else if we can. But the pew distance really works out well. So good to have you in God's house. And thank you, Harold. Harold Crane. Now, I know because I knew your dad in Michigan, the Crane name. And you are a beloved brother to sainted beloved Carol Crane Lettergar. Thank you for serving so regularly. Where do you live at, Harold?
Peoria.
Thanks for coming in, and Sandy for working everything so nicely with music today. Our theme is Invitation to Joy, based on all of the readings. You'll see the connections, and maybe not so much with the gospel, but I'll be explaining that as we arrive there in worship. Holy Communion, again, in the pew, and if you could kind of move more towards the aisles closest to you at communion time, that would be helpful as we distribute at that time. Our opening hymn, the beautiful hymn, Beethoven, I think, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. Let us stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared. Since we are gathered to hear God's word and call upon him in prayer and praise in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together, as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Together. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Upon this, your confession, I, as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God to you. In the stead, by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated for the hymn or anthem of praise, In Christ Alone, Joy and Praise.
Stone, this solid ground, but through the fiercest round.
be with you. You may remain seated for our prayer of the day as we join together in praying. Lord Jesus Christ, whose grace always precedes and follows us, help us to forsake all trust in earthly gain and to find in you our heavenly treasure. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We listen now to the first two lessons from Scripture.
The Old Testament lesson is from Isaiah, chapter 25, verses 6 through 9. On this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats and the finest of wines. On this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove his people's disgrace from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. In that day they will say, surely this is our God. We trusted in him, and he saved us. This is the Lord. We trusted in him. Let us rejoice and be glad in his salvation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson is from Philippians, chapter 4, verses 4 through 13. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I am not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all this through him who gives me strength. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We stand as we are able. Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 22nd chapter. Glory to you, Lord. Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some more servants and said, 'Tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fattened cattle have been butchered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his field, another to his business. The rest seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. So go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find.' So the servants went out, into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, the bad as well as the good. And the wedding hall was filled with guests. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. The hymn of the day, we sing it twice through, Rejoice in the Lord Always. Grace and peace to you in the name of Christ, our living Savior. Invitation to joy, based upon the second verse. The kingdom of heaven is like a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. The king had prepared well. We don't have the record of the actual invitation, but it's referred to those who had been invited. He had taken care, probably an invitation like this one to the royal wedding for His Royal Highness. He sent out then servants to summon them to this, well, at this time in the Middle East, the first of the two meals of the day, usually about 10:30 or what we would say 11 o'clock in the morning. It's all ready. But they were unwilling to come. Again, he sent out other servants and enticed them. I prepared the meal, and it's a good one. We're going to have beef, rare in those days. It's all ready. Come to the wedding banquet. But more rejection, indifference. And I wrote here violent, but no, more than violence, murder. Talk about a kerplunk, party pooper, enraged, the king, justifiable in his indignation, destroys those murderers and sets aflame their city. William Barclay, in something of an understatement, comments here, this introduction of murder and armies and burning of the city seems out of place in connection with the wedding feast. That's so true. Well, where does that come from? This is a parable. Ballo, we get our word ballistic from it, to throw something. Para, like lines parallel next to each other. Stories thrown next to each other, one with the heavenly meaning, the other the earthly connection. And so the son, God's own, the wedding banquet in him. And, well, what's happened with the murder? It's happened over time. The prophets, no question, bringing God's word and God's invitation. But I think more contemporary, too. Let me explain. To understand why this is included in such an extensive way, three parables in Matthew, Mark and Luke, one or two, but that's it. But in Matthew, all three. I agree with a man named F.F. Bruce that, and early art, medieval art about Matthew, that uniformly pictures him as an older man, a rare man in those days, who lived the 80 years, who actually made it that far. And all the paintings depict him that way. I believe Matthew wrote this gospel, but later he lived a longer life. You know, he had been kind of pampered early on as a tax collector, Levi, but he didn't eat too much rich food as he became an apostle later. He lived a little longer and then dictated, probably in Aramaic, the gospel to his scribe, which wrote it down in Greek. And there are indications, if you know the languages a little bit, F.F. Bruce more than I do. At any rate, he wrote the gospel sometime between 75 and 85 A.D., I believe, after the destruction of Jerusalem by the Romans. By this time, Masada, where the leaders held fast, not the regular folk. The Romans took, what, 2 years, we're told in history, to lay siege and take the city, not because it was that tough for them. They were giving a chance for hoi polloi, the regular people, to escape. And many did. But the leaders held fast, and they were destroyed. The temple was sacked and burned by the Romans. In fact, the stones were taken off the temple and broken up and scattered around the area. It's still rocky all over there because of that. Only one stone section remains, the Wailing or Western supportive wall. Destruction had come to those who failed to recognize God's Son. Now, I'm not saying Matthew made this up, and so he added to, but he did add to the record as it already existed. It was uppermost in his mind. He looked back on this and said, oh, Holy Week, that's what Jesus was talking about. I'm going to record all the parables he gave at that mind. So what seems excessive, you know, is really kind of explained with that history. But we still kind of get stuck there, don't we? I'd like to move us along. The parable is about much more. It is, in fact, an invitation to joy, a feast, banquet, good eats, Isaiah 25, good wine, aged on the dregs is the word in the Hebrew. Really good stuff. We like our wine filtered, but on the dregs is the best. But feast or banquet in Hebrew, and down to us in religious terms, remember Pastor Walt always talked about the feast of the Nativity of our Lord, right? You can hear it. The feast. It has a religious overtone, too. So before the good eats and the good wine, prayer. Thank you, the Masarakises, for this photo. And then after the good eats, dancing. And if you're really blessed, Greek dancing. Their wedding, too. Joy. It's an invitation to a banquet. Now, oftentimes Christianity is seen as kind of gloom and doom. Oh, you've got to give up everything, you know, that Lenten life. We're giving up for the Lord. And, well, you need to hear the gospel so you avoid hell. Now, hell is something to be avoided. Absolutely. But the invitation is one of joy, that repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, is about leaving behind all that entangles and destroys, not just for eternity, but think about it, here and now. I guess Hindu neighbors call it karma. We see plenty of it when people go the other direction. It's judgment. It's a call to joy, though, in Jesus. And we're reminded this is an invitation to joy, the banquet. We're also reminded by this parable of those things that make us deaf to God and make people deaf. It's true that the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. There's a warring aspect to it. It can become murderous in its opposition to God and God's ways. But there's another aspect here that is less extreme. One goes to the farm, the other to the business, to the estate. Big farm, to the business. It's really their possessive, his. Well, they're taking all the credit for what's going on there. Well, this is a very present temptation for us too. We don't have to go right now. Many of us aren't driving as much as we did before. The elders are meeting upcoming, and they're looking at, well, as people return to church, and we pray more and more do, you know, many don't want to sit in the fireside room. What do we do? How do we accommodate that? And one of the topics being talked about is Saturday service. Should Saturday service be renewed, and will people actually go to it? And there were two people that talked to me about it, and the chairman of the elders said, be sure to have them talk with me. So I thought one did. And the other didn't. So I called him and I said, well, if you want to, now or forever hold your peace, kind of thing. And I said, well, things have changed for us, Pastor. You know, we're not driving to work anymore. So we have more time. And so Saturday service isn't as critical. But if you're one of the people who says, yes, Saturday service is important to us, I think it's an important outreach in a predominantly Catholic area, by the way, contact me and I'll give you the contact information for the chairman of our elders, Dennis Smith, if you don't have it, and you'll need to make that contact. At any rate, things have changed. We're not going so much. So we have a little more time, right? But there's also a temptation. It's always there, that phone or that iPad. You know, work is not bad in itself. God gave work before the fall. It wasn't the result of sin. Take care of the garden. Work is good in its place. But it's easy to get caught up in providing a house that the blessing of home is lost. We get so caught up in the temporal and the immediate that the eternal and the real values, in earthly terms too, are pushed off to the side. Again, Barclay, the tragedy of life is that so often second bests shut out the best. What is good in itself shuts out the supreme. And finally, we are reminded that this joy is all by grace. Good and bad filled the banquet hall. I think in scriptural terms of those shepherds, they were considered people of the land, the kind of bad ones. Invited to the birth. Levi to become Matthew because Jesus said, hey, I'll go to your house and talk with you. And what a wonderful spread. Those that finally are there couldn't expect to ever have a fancy meal like that. You know, I'm a Southsider. Joanne gets embarrassed when I admit this, but it's still true. I sit down to a real fancy meal at a wedding. Real fancy one. And I still have to look at those forks and discipline myself. Use that one first. And don't put that little spoon at the head of the plate. That just will rattle my world. That's all there. They didn't know what to do. But they were invited by the generous hospitality of the King, God. You know, earthly achievements have their place. In our neighborhood, there are all kinds of signs. And Steve, I love those signs for students. Honor roll, graduate, all that. But I ran across this sign. I don't know Benjamin personally, but he keeps his car up. and he mows the lawn occasionally. And he's now the scholar recipient for the IBEW. And congratulations to Benjamin and his family, and they should be proud of that. And God bless him in his calling in life. But before God, before the holy God, if we say, hey, we deserve it, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive our sins. He will welcome us. It's important to follow God's way, finally, to him, and away, yes, from judgment. I couldn't help but put this up. They're two unicorns, you know, and one is saying, big storms a brewing, and the other, then I'm glad we didn't go on that cruise thing with your whack job friend Noah. God calls us finally, though, to joy in the Lord. That brings that peace that passes all understanding, that connects everything, because God connects with us. Jerry was telling me, and Jerry, you've seen this many times, I think. You've traveled over there, led tours. And this is the moment that traditionally the soul enters Adam, breathed into him the breath of life. That connection is made. And that connection is literally made in a banquet that we have. God's gift of himself, his own son for us, his body given, his blood shed for forgiveness, life, and salvation. God is faithful and just through Christ and will forgive our sins and welcome us. And so we rejoice in the Lord. Again, rejoice. And then let your gentleness be evident to all. Epiakes is the word there in Greek. And it's hard to kind of translate. I'm trying to go back to the Hebrew for which Paul thought, you know. It's recorded in Greek, but Paul thought more in Hebrew. And it kind of goes with forbearance and maybe in modern terms, cutting a little slack. Cut some slack. You know, there's a program now, besides Zoom, for meeting. It's called Slack. And it's named that because if you meet, you know, that way, you have a little extra time. You're not driving to a meeting or flying to a meeting. You got cut a little slack, but prepare well for the meeting. You know, I think that's an important aspect for us to think about. That was uppermost in Paul's mind. Because Paul was a guy of high expectations. You know, I'll admit this, Joanne was at 8 o'clock. I've been, over the years, a kind of boy named Sue dad in some ways. I've had some pretty high expectations. The kids will tell you that. They'll say, man, you were pretty hard on us at times. I say, yeah. Well, sorry when it wasn't appropriate. But now they're old enough to say, hey, thanks for some of it. I'm on time for work now. And there are a lot of good things happening in my life, too. But you know, it speaks to me, let your gentleness be evident to all. Einstein had a little quote that every now and again you read Einstein and it makes a really fascinating connection with the intelligence of God, if you will. This one I think is kind of neat. Weak people revenge, strong people forgive, intelligent people ignore. There are times in gentleness that I had to remind myself, I'd look in that room and it was a mess. But that day, I just closed the door and keep going. There were more than a few times. At about 2 a.m, when I had to remind myself to say, we'll talk about it at daylight after church. Together, in church too. But we'll talk then. That gentleness and that reminder, at least in a lot of those moments for me, was kind of a call of grace. The call of grace to me. If we say we're without sin, we deceive ourselves. Joanne likes to say an important aspect of parenting is to be able to say, hey, I blew that one, honestly. Sorry about that. To really recognize that whatever our stance in life, we're finally children of God, and the Father, the King, has come to us as we relate to each other, even ministers, gently. Around the cross of Jesus Christ, with our shared brokenness, if you will, but that kind of pulling together that comes through the Son, who reaches to us with his cross-marked hand, and then sends us forth in that gentleness. No warring madness here, but in gentleness to others, inviting them to joy in the Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
I have to remind myself what I'm doing. I've got remotes. It's like at home. You got all these remotes. Am I supposed to use that remote now or not? No, we've got a wonderful tech team, and we're all queued up now for the Nicene Creed. Let us stand and confess this Creed of the Church, especially spoken and joined together in at celebrations of Holy Communion. We confess, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated for the offering time, and we thank you very much for your ongoing support of ministry here and beyond here and reaching in, reaching up, and reaching out. Our offering music for the Beauty of the Earth Handbell Choir and Junior Chimers. Thank you.
Well, thank you to our handbellers and to all who worked to mix that so beautifully. That was really nicely done. Brian and Sandy, I think, principally work on those things and wonderfully presented. Well, a wonderful partner in ministry. I'd like to invite forward now Jerry Bronzell. Jerry, the head of our Stephen ministry. And Jerry, I'll brag on you. When I came here, I think there were quite a few Stephen ministries that were operative in churches. And ours is not only one of the few remaining, but it's really grown and done very, very well. And I appreciate your leadership in that respect. Sir, we're going to have you come right up here, I think, because of the mic. And you can, you're far enough away to take off your mask if you want, okay?
Thank you, Pastor. This morning I was at the 8 o'clock.
How refreshing it is to be outside with a gorgeous breeze and experience some spiritual togetherness, because my wife and I have been actually hibernating spiritually since the beginning for obvious reasons. Great to be here and see smiling eyes. I can't say faces, but I say smiling eyes and masks. It's great to be here. First of all, I'd like to thank the tech crew for the marvelous job that they have done in preparing and synchronizing this presentation. And Mike Fisher and that group are just, look, they're closer to heaven up there, working up there. Just thank you very, very much. And you've come a long way since that first Sunday we were down in March. You've really advanced and become very sophisticated. Makes me proud to be here. Okay, I recently ran across this prayer and realized that it is appropriate considering the trying times we have been experiencing the last 7 months due to COVID-19. God of love and mercy, assist me in this time of trouble and anxiety. Ease my burdens, strengthen my faith, that I may increase my trust and confidence in your compassionate care. Give me the courage I need, dear Lord, to face the difficulties before me. I pray for a share of your healing graces and ask that you surround me with your comforting goodness and for a heart filled with hope and peace. Amen. Then a couple of weeks ago, Stephen Ministry headquarters out of St. Louis issued a bulletin that included this Bible verse from Matthew 11. There it is. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. I will give you rest. At the risk of making an understatement, I would say that we are experiencing some unprecedented time, trying times in our daily lives. I'm sure most of us feel unsure and unsettled about a number of unexpected things in our daily lives. We'd like to take a few moments of your time to let you know that you don't have to do it alone. You don't have to do it alone. We currently have 14. Great job, Mike. We currently have 14 commissioned Stephen ministers who are members of Christ Lutheran Church. The Holy Spirit has gifted our commissioned Stephen ministers by opening their hearts to serve God as ministers of compassion and care. Stephen Ministries' mission actually blends in with our mission statement here at Christ Lutheran, which is reaching out by reaching in and reaching up. Are you feeling exhausted from all the disruptions of life brought on by the pandemic? Are you or someone you know struggling with the challenges like isolation and loneliness, anxiety over health, grief due to many different kinds of losses, tensions from juggling work, children, schooling, financial strain or job loss? Uncertainty about the future or other unexpected life changes. Keep in mind, you do not have to go it alone. If you feel a need to, in these trying times, for a shoulder to lean on, someone trained and experienced in a proper way of listening, someone who genuinely cares for you as a Christian, someone who has taken a solemn vow to maintain complete confidentiality. If so, there are 14 Stephen ministers available to serve you. What do you think, Mike? Okay, Carl and Julie Jancek, not as a team. Okay. Mary Lee Roach, Bill Wong, George Zolik, Carol Balboa, Jerry and Joanne Bronzel, now not as a team also. Mary Garrett, Rose Gronke, Karen Griefy, Eleanor Massler, and John Meister. A Stephen minister will meet with you privately to offer care and support. You can contact either Pastor Ray, Pastor Chuck, or myself. Just call the office. Please remember that we Stephen ministers are Christian caregivers, that Jesus, and Jesus is the cure giver. Remember, please. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, I will give you rest. Thank you very much.
And we have a number of Stephen ministers here with us personally. So if you're a Stephen minister, raise your hands, would you? Okay. And back there, Bill is there. And yeah. God be praised for all your wonderful ministry and Jerry for your leadership. We prepare our hearts now for prayer. The response is, hear our prayer as we have our prayer time, then Holy Communion. I'm just kind of setting things up for our assistants initially. As we commune as well, know that you'll be receiving the elements in an open palm, please. If you just keep one of your palms open, we can kind of place it in the palm without having contact issues. Let us stand for prayer. Lord God, your invitation is to joy, away from sin and death, that corrupt and drag us down ultimately. Thank you for the work of the Holy Spirit to receive your invitation in holy baptism and in faith. Forgive us when our lives are less than joyous in the Lord. Renew us in your grace and hope, even through this very trying time. And having received the joy of your grace, move us to epiakes, gentleness, with your grace and truth. Truth, yes, about sin and just judgment, but grace. C.F.W. Walter, how did he put it? The gospel needs to be central and predominate as we relate to others and invite them to life in the Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our nation, Lord. Thank you for preserving us and for bringing back to health our president and first lady. We pray your aid in the elections now taking place for order and accuracy, and that we would exercise our civic duty for the blessing of our nation, for our common blessed life together, for greatest and least, and for justice and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, give grace and comfort to any who might be grieving at this time. I think of Anne Schrider, her beloved Heinz's service, Abraham Lincoln, just on Friday. Ongoing prayers for Anne and Stephen and Adam in commending Heinz. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give grace and healing mercy, we pray, to those who are ill or injured, those awaiting surgery or in therapy recovery. And so among them, we pray for Bonnie, Bill, David L., Gwen, Joey, Kelly, Louise, Paul, Donna, Lydia, Linda, Jane, Rose, Jane, Jan, Frida, Lord, as Lord, you direct her care and you guide family together in that care. We pray for Gail, Carol, Fred and Barbara, Carol, recovering well now, Paul, Ken, doing well, ongoing cancer care. We pray for Angela, Keith, Charles, Gail, Marvin and Joy, for Carrie, Lord, as she needs your help and is in ICU. We pray, O Lord, for Morgan, and Lord, ongoing blessing and recovery for Judy with us now. We also add to this list Arlene Carlson. Arlene experienced heart difficulty and turned out to be an attack. Good care, Lord, there in Michigan. We thank you for it and blessing that intervention procedure. We pray your blessing, everything stable and doing well. Thank you, Lord, for that grace. Continue to strengthen Ken and Arlene and family. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we rejoice in your good gifts. My goodness. Yesterday, the marriage of Jamie and Alex, now Zavala, anticipating this week, Jordan Staskel and Christopher LeClaire, sharing of their vows with joy and prayer and your blessing. We rejoice this very day with Elmer Brosh and family. Mr. Brosh, celebrating his 107th birthday today. Thank you for time sharing communion this past week. Bless, O Lord, the car parade that's going to happen sometime around noon. And give joy to faithful Elmer. Thank you for the health and strength you've given him. And we rejoice with Lorraine Rolfs, my own mother, who's celebrating her 90th birthday on Monday. Small gathering of family outside today. We give thanks for Mom and for the blessings you've given her in health and strength. My goodness, 410. Wow, that's just great. Continue to be with her and bless her. Even as now, due to age, she can't be with us in worship. 2-3 hours a day out is about as much as she can handle. But Lord, you're sustaining and granting grace to this prayer warrior in our family. Continue to hold Mom in your mercy. And, O Lord, we rejoice with Ed and Barbara Kernbauer as they're celebrating their 60th wedding anniversary on Thursday the 15th. Thank you for the honoring love that they've shown one another, that kind of faithful leadership in their marriage and family, and continue to hold them in mercy and in grace as they share that blessing of love from on high in their marriage together. Lord, now in this moment of silence, we pause to lift before you our own thanksgivings or needs. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, thank you for your grace throughout the whole church, the supper of communion, the banquet, a foretaste of the feast to come. And so we think of the angels, the archangels, and all the company of heaven. With the whole church this week, we consider the faithful lives of St. Philip, deacon, might call him Stephen Minister, Teresa of Avila, Ignatius, Bishop and Martyr, 115. And St. Luke, Evangelist and Physician. Grant us grace with them to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. And so we prepare our hearts now with this Eucharistic prayer for the reception of Holy Communion. Merciful God, we do not presume to approach your table, trusting in our righteousness. We are not worthy to have you come under the eaves of our homes, but in your abundant mercy, you come to us. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat and drink the body and blood of our dear Savior, Jesus Christ, that we may live in him and he in us, now and forever. In Jesus' name we pray, and with the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you and for many for the remission of sin. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Jesus.
We stand as we are able. The body and blood of our Lord strengthen and preserve you steadfast in the one true faith to life everlasting. Go in peace. Amen. Let us bow our heads for prayer. Lord God, as you have come to us with the gift of your Son in this Eucharistic banquet, gather us into one and fill us with your Holy Spirit to establish faith in truth and to propel us in joy-filled and gentle life together and witness through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn verses, O Living Bread from Heaven. Be seated. Barbara, happy anniversary to you and Ed, and congratulations. 60 years? Wow, fantastic. How have you done it with that? I just. Well, God be with you and greetings to you. And of course, Mr. Brosh, 107. If you feel inclined to be part of that car parade, they're gathering 104th Avenue at about 130th, you know, there, the fire station, just north of the house, and then 11:15, then going by at about noon. Some of you know Elmer, and they'll happily make you part of that train if you prefer. I can't be there because, well, Mom's get-together is right at noon, 90th. Wow, what a joy. Any other birthdays being celebrated? Terry. Oh, my goodness, really? And that's right, you share a birthday. Wow. Was there ever a point when you were dating that you found that out and said, this is foreordained? Can't get out of this, wouldn't want to. Right? Oh, my goodness, wow, happy birthdays.
Two grandsons.
Oh, a lot of joy in the Vence clan. Fantastic. Good, good. Back there, Chris? Your birthday Friday. Oh, happy birthday. I'm sorry?
And Bruce too.
Really? And Bruce's as well. So you make that connection, right? Oh, happy birthday to you guys. All right. Others? Any? Okay. I haven't missed anybody. We've got more coming in, but just in a minute we'll have that. No drive-up communion today, and again, I mentioned in the sermon, you know, trying to figure things out. So if you are a Saturday person and you want to see that resume, be sure to let me know and I'll give you the contact information and you can make your case or whatever for that option moving forward. Hopefully, we'll have more people coming back to church, so we'll need to be safe. We intend to be very safe. According to the rules right now, we could have, 120 people in this church, but I don't think that'd be safe. Do you? So we're going to kind of work it out so we're not using other spaces and kind of being cheek to jowl a little too much here. We want to have more space than less that's safe. Tuesday, quilters and church council meet. Thursday, joy and praise practice. Sunday, drive up communion, and in an ongoing way through to, is it December or through December to January? I didn't see the email, but we're going to continue drive up communion. The elders will, I think it's January 1 through to that time, and we're going to have a couple teams serving two cars at a time and then coming in to get warm. That's the idea, so that we stay healthy ourselves. So know that drive up communion will blessedly continue. Mark, COVID update. If you could share with us, and then we'll have birthdays.
Oh, okay. Good morning. Well, as of this morning, COVID is still here. It's not going anywhere anytime soon. So today we have like 56 people in here, and as Pastor Ray mentioned, like 80 is our max going all the way through the fireside room. So thank you for your patience in trying to seat everybody when we're doing here. So there's no registration going to happen anytime soon. If we have too many people, it's a good thing. We'll figure it out one way or the other on what we have to do. So thank you for that. You are definitely a blessing to us all. Next thing. The masks that were ordered, they just came in. I just received them now. So if anybody desires to have a mask, we ask that we could probably, because they're just sitting in a box right now, that we get a little more organized, and then next week we could pass them out when the service comes. So that's that. Last thing is, October is Pastor Appreciation Month, and today is Pastor Appreciation Day. So I ask that we give a hand to Pastor Ray and Pastor Chuck for all that they do. You do a fine job. We appreciate all your efforts. That is it. God bless you all.
Thank you.
Have a great week.
Thank you. George, you've now that's come in, right? The notes and there have been prayer requests.
Yes.
There have been birthdays, anniversaries.
And we have a few here. Bruce Van Auken is celebrating his 69th birthday on the 16th, and Bob and Karen Griefy are celebrating their joint birthdays. Just a note here that Jeanette Hafner is having her eye surgery this week, so we ask God's blessings on her for a speedy recovery. And there's a couple here. Donald Johnson and Len Johnson, their 27th wedding anniversary is celebrated on October 9th. Cindy Miller is celebrating her 14th wedding anniversary. And Adele Marshall notes that Chris Libitor's birthday is October 17th. That's it for birthdays and anniversaries.
My mic on, working with that so well. Thank you so much. And yeah, Cindy and Todd, the Millers, celebrating too, and the Johnsons. So wow, lots of anniversaries. Fall weddings are coming back, by the way. We've really noticed that here. Any other announcements to share that I might have missed? Well, Lord be with you, and we'll see you under the portico.